So if you want an analysis of Steve Gadd's playing during those 8-bar exchanges with the late, great Chick Corea, stay tuned. Welcome. I consider this video a tribute to Chick Corea, but I'm doing so via an examination of Steve Gadd's playing with him. But before I get into it, make sure to click the red subscribe button and ring the notification bell so you're aware of every time I upload a new video. Chick Corea and Steve Gadd have been friends for many moons. They met at a Long Island jam session in 1965. A couple of years later, Chick had stopped playing with Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers and started playing with Chuck Mangione. At the same time, Steve Gadd was the drummer for that band, so they actually played together in that group. After that, their paths diverged. Steve Gadd actually went and joined the Army, and he played as a musician in the Army for 3 years. At the same time, Chick had started really digging into his career. He played with Miles, and he started recording his own solo records, like Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. Also, Chick had started to put together the original Return to Forever group with Erto and Flora Purim. So that was especially interesting. Steve actually caught that band at the Village Vanguard one night and said, "Hey, if you ever need me, give me a call." So Chick Corea was starting to turn Return to Forever into a more of an electric group with Bill Connors on guitar, Stanley Clark on bass, and Mingo Lewis on percussion. And this is where Steve Gadd came in. So actually, Steve Gadd played with that band for the early part of 1973, playing the music that ended up on Hymn of the Seventh Galaxy, that recording, which is a great record. However, things kind of changed right there because Steve was starting to do a lot of recordings. He was a studio musician, and Chick was ready to go on the road. So at the time, Steve had 2 kids, and was really in the scene in New York as a studio drummer, and couldn't leave town. So Lenny White ended up taking over the drum chair for Return Forever, and the rest is history for that band. But at the same time, Steve's playing sure took off, and he had a legendary role in music from that period as well. They actually didn't come together until, 2 records in 1976. Also, he played in a few tracks on The Mad Hatter. The 76 records were The Leprechaun and My Spanish Heart. And also, I think there was a record called Friends that Steve Gadd played on as well. After that, in the 80s, he did the classic record Three Quartets. So in truth, they didn't tour together for all those years until a couple of years ago. In 2016, they got together and formed an actual group that made a record called Chinese Butterfly. So on this video, I'm going to have analysis of 5 elements of Steve Gadd's playing on a song on My Spanish Heart called Spanish Fantasy Number 2. And it's a piano drum set duet. In the middle of the song, Chick and Steve trade eights. And it's really playful and fascinating and exciting. So I decided to do a cover of that, like you just saw. And I'm gonna break down the elements of Steve's playing during those 8-bar exchanges. Okay, so let's get right into it. All right, so the first thing I should mention is that I'll be doing these exercises at 108 BPM rather than 138 BPM. This is, of course, so we can slow things down and you can get a better view on what's going down. Okay, so the first element I consider to be groove-based. In other words, if you were to play the element on its own or the germ on its own, it would sound like a groove. Steve plays this one both as an accompaniment with Chick and also soloistically. All right, so here's the first element. And slower. The second example of this is pretty much the same, except for it's just has one less ride cymbal note in it. Sounds like this. Slower. You can tell I like that one. I had to repeat it one more time. Okay, the second element is a pretty common musical concept, and that is switching gears between duple and ternary time. So you're boogieing along, playing 16th notes and 8th notes and 32nd notes, and then all of a sudden you switch into triplets, 8th note triplets, you know, quarter note triplets, and so on. So here's a couple of examples of him doing that. The way Steve does it, I don't know, it just seems to have a little extra sauce on it. His magic, I guess. And slower. Three E and a four E and one E and a two E and a three triplet, four triplet, two triplet, three E and a four E and a one. Now this next example of this element is even more stark because he literally plays 16th notes that run into 8th note triplets. And slower. Three E and a four E and a one E and a two E and a three E and a four triplet, two triplet, three triplet, four triplet, one triplet, three triplet, four triplet, one. Yeah. When you count like that, you can really see, you can really feel the tug of the gear shifting, right? And that's something that you should probably practice in any case, switching from 16ths to triplets. Just going back and forth, getting used to that feel. All right, the next element, element three, is hymiola based. And hymiola, of course, is playing three note groups in duple time. In this case, you would probably think in terms of 16th notes, so three note groups, 16th notes, in 4/4 time. When you do that, at the end of the bar, you're going to have one less 16th note. So that means the phrase starts before you get on to the next bar, beat one on the next bar. So therefore, the pattern goes over the bar line, okay? So that's what hymiola will do. Here we go. And count it out slowly. Three E and a four All right. Now, this next humula pattern, I would say that Steve Gadd plays this particular pattern probably out of all the soloistic stuff he plays. I would say he puts this into his music 85 to 90% of the time. Definitely one of his very favorites. And the way he does it, no one else can do it like him. A lot of people use this, including myself. But man, when he launches into this stuff, it is so locked and it feels so good. Classic Steve Gadd. Okay, so I'm sure anyone who's followed his playing has heard this one before. Right? Oh man, that's like surefire excitement. If you launch into that one, you know, especially near the end of a solo, that'll cause hearts to flutter. Okay. But yeah, he puts that in a lot of stuff. It's great. Great sounds, awesome, and it feels good. All right. The last humula-oriented element that I found in this little interchange between Chick Corea and Steve Gadd goes like this. And slower. Okay. Yeah, that one feels really good too. Definitely full, causes lots of excitement. In fact, Steve plays that near the end of this whole trading eight section, and yeah, the effect of it is pretty fabulous. All right, another thing that Steve Gadd does is element number four, is that he'll play triplets, you know, fundamental trips between two toms and kick, but led by the kick drum. All right, led by the kick drum. So the kick drum is really playing the basic subdivision, or the weight, or the, yeah, I guess you'd call it the subdivision. It's playing the subdivision, the rhythmic note value that's sort of underlying this triplet soloistic concept. Okay, so here we go. Element four. And slower. Three and four and one and two and three and four and two and three and four and one. Okay. Great. Now you can take that same principle and subdivide the kick drum on the quarter note triplet. So that'd be. And add a triplet on each one of those. So that pattern is in there as well. Okay, great. But lastly, in one of his accompaniment sections, you find element number five, a simple, good old-fashioned samba. Good old-fashioned samba, really? Samba, okay? And Yeah, this is the one that he plays. Now, understand that the rhythmic elements that are being played between the hands compared to the ostinato on the foot are pretty improvised, but within the context of samba rhythms. Okay, he's not playing a real straight traditional samba on this. It's kind of free-flowing on top. And the bottom is playing that typical surdu samba feel. Well, it's not really. I would say it's more of a drum set adaptation. That's more fair, I would say. Okay, here we go. So yeah, very typical samba, and that's something, like I said, is a favorite of Steve Gadd's. And also, a great samba to check out from him is on a song called Samba Song on Chick Corea's Friends. Yeah, those two, like this, right? Okay, so here it is slowed down. 3 e and a 4 e and a 1 e and a 2 e and a 3 e and a 4 e and a 2 e and a 2 e and a 3 e and a 4 e and a 3 e and a 2 e and a 3 e and a 4 e and a 4 e and a 2 e and a 3 e and a 4 e and a 5 e and a 2 e and a 3 e and a... So I hope you enjoyed this tribute really to Chick Corea via Steve Gadd. I just don't play keyboards well enough to play a piece by him. Although there is one I did do a children's song once. But nonetheless, Chick was a real influence to the whole world. He was a gift to mankind. As my teacher, Jim Blackley, once described genius musicians, they're gifts to us and we are to learn from them. And he was quite the teacher and performer. Steve Gadd's playing with him is legendary. Their combination of drums and keyboards or piano, wow, some of the best stuff ever has been recorded with those two. And their work together is also very well documented on a lot of records, especially during the 70s. So if you enjoyed this video, please like it and share it. Go to Aubrey Drum Lessons for more drumming info. You can also book Zoom lessons there with me. I've been doing lots and lots of them over the last year, and it's been a blast teaching online. Also, lastly, you can reach me on Instagram. So take care, stay safe, and I look forward to the next one.
Thanks for watching my video. Really glad you did that. Subscribe. And click here if you want more performance and lesson videos.